Hi everyone, welcome back to this series of Amibroker tutorial videos. Thank you very much for joining me. It's absolutely fantastic to have you here. The last video we looked at doing a trailing stop using the average true range, also what's known as a chandelier type stop. And in that video, I promised that I would do another video on how to actually plot that stop on a chart. Now this would apply to any use of the ApplyStop function. Because usually when we do like a buy or sell signal, it's fairly easy to plot it. All we have to do is type in plot and then the arrays that we've used, for example, you know, setting up our buy or sell signals, name them, turn them into a line, and pretty much away we go. Using ApplyStop is a little bit different because technically it's not an array that we've set up. So here's the detail from the last video, and basically all we've done is set up a buy signal for a close over a moving average of the last 150 days, and then we set up our 3x average true range of the last 10 days, and then we set up our stop loss. So our stop type was trailing stop. It was we measured it in points, and those points were measured by the average true range of the last 10 days and 3x that. Now the other things were just setting up so that we could exit the next day and obviously wait one day to re-enter as well. As usual, if we do a quick Google search and say Amibroker plot apply stop, then the first thing that comes up is a great article on the Amibroker website itself. I highly recommend checking it out, and that will give you a few details in actually plotting that apply stop there as well. It needs to actually run this stop loss for it to actually work, and in order to do that in our code, the first thing we do is type equity and 1 and 0. What that will do is evaluate all the stops over all of the quotes. The next thing we need to do is tell our code when we're actually in a trade or not. So if we just create an array and we want that just to be in trade, we can call it anything we like, but just for simplicity's sake, we'll call it in trade. Now this is where the flip function comes in, and this is something that I hadn't actually used before, but it's really excellent. Basically it acts like a switch. So if we type flip and open up our bracket, it'll tell us what it looks for. And all it's looking for is two arrays. Now the first array, basically, once that happens, then it turns to true. And when the second array happens, then it turns to false. So it's literally like a light switch. It's really great. So to turn on our light switch, we want that to be when our buy signal happens. So pretty simple stuff. And also to turn off our light switch, we just want that to be when our sell signal happens or our apply stop. Now we're going to need this in just a short little while, but before we do, we need to set one last option. And to do that, we just say set option. It turns blue. That's what we're looking for. And the option we're looking for is every bar null check. And we want that to be set to true. If we close that off with a semicolon, that will just check for null bars in our code and make sure that there aren't any. Now we can get to actually creating the array that we want to plot. So things are a little bit easier from here on in. But the array that we want to create, again, we can call it anything we like, but what we're creating is our stop loss line. So let's just call it stop line for now. Now, this is where we say we use the if function or if then else. So when we type IIF, that's our if then else. So in other words, if this condition, then it returns this. Otherwise, it returns this. So the condition that we're looking for is in trade. So if we are in a trade, then we want to plot our apply stop. Now we can't just go about plotting this apply stop again, because it's not an array that we actually created ourselves. But what we can do is use the array that we created, which is our average true range, and we can hang that from the highest bar. So this is how we do it. If we say highest since, there we go. So highest since turns blue. And if we open that bracket, it's asking for a condition. So if we say the highest since our buy signal, then we want it to return the high minus our chandelier stop. So think about what that's doing. All it's doing is it's looking for the highest value of this since we bought. So our stop is only going to be plotted once we buy. Otherwise, it's not going to be plotted. That's exactly what we want. So highest since our buy signal. And don't forget, this is only happening if in trade, and in trade is a switch, and it only turns on if we've bought, and it turns off once we've sold. So that again helps us to make sure that the apply stop only shows up if we're actually in a trade. So it's the highest since our buy signal, and then it's the actual high of any particular bar minus our stop length, which is the average true range of the last 10 days and three times that. So once we've got that, you can obviously see it on the chart. If we've got three times that range there, and it's hanging from the very highest high of that particular bar, then as you can see, that's pretty much where that stop line is operating. Now, all we need to do to finish off this line is our last condition, because remember there were three things. If in trade, then return the highest since the buy price, or you know, the buy signal, and return our high minus stop length. But what happens if it's not correct? Then we just want nothing to happen. So we want null there. And just close the bracket and close off that line with a semicolon as well. And now finally, we can actually plot our array. Because we've turned that into an array for ourselves, now we can actually plot it. Now, before we do, really quickly, obviously you might have different stop losses or trailing stop losses that you want to put on your chart. Now, this is where it does get a tiny bit tricky because you do have to figure this little part out for yourself. So if you've got a percentage, for example, obviously you could set up a percentage as an array up here, turn it into a dollar figure, and then take that off the high here as well instead of our normal stop length. So a little bit of mathematics might be involved depending on what type of stop loss you're using. But you know, these are the fun things to figure out. So usually it doesn't take too much, maybe a little bit of time. You know, you can even take your laptop up, watch a bit of TV and figure this stuff out usually. It's not too difficult. I always say if I can figure it out, then anyone should be able to figure it out, because I'm a C student in maths, basically. I was terrible at this stuff. Lastly, plotting our array. So we've got plot, it's asking for the array, and that's stop line. That's the one that we set up right here. We can call this anything we like. Awesome. Stop loss. Obviously, use something that you would like to, that you prefer. We'll set up our color. And to do that, we can type in color, and then we can have a fiddle around and play around with a few different colors. It will turn bold if it recognizes it. There we go. So we've got color blue. For example, if it's a stop loss, traditionally we might use the color red. And here we go is the style. And again, it's looking for the style here. And we could do a few different styles, but style line will turn it bold, and that's what it's actually looking for. The last few things we don't need to worry about for this particular code, and so we just put zeros, or you may be able to just leave it as well, potentially. You know, try a few different things. That really should work. So if I save that, and then just go check, happy days, there's no errors appearing, and that's exactly what I'm after. So if I close that down, and if I just delete this indicator here, so that we've got a clean slate, now I'll just find the one that we coded and drag it across. Great, so there's our line. Now you might notice that there's no buy or sell arrows, and you're absolutely right. If I just edit this formula to put in our buy or sell arrows, it's pretty simple. All we do is plot shapes, and you can see that turns blue so that it does recognize it. We open up our bracket, and if we say by times or by asterisk shape up arrow, and again, because it's looking for a shape, we just type in shape, and then we can try a few different things. We could put shape circle. There you go, see, it recognizes that because it turns bold. But let's stick with the up arrow for now. The next one, we want it to be a certain color, so we'll type in color. If it's a buy signal, we'll type in color green. The layer, we're happy with layer zero, that's no problem. The position, where do we want it to be positioned? Let's put the buy arrow at the low of the bar. And let's just see if we can close that off and see if that works as is. And it does. So there's our buy signals. And as you can see, there's our trailing stop loss, and that's where it will sell. Obviously, you can set up the same thing for your down arrows at the sell signal. Really simple to do, just basically the opposite. So you'd say sell asterisk shape down arrow, for example, color red perhaps, and you might put that at the high of the bar as well, or wherever you want. You can put it at the array that you want it to appear at, anywhere really. You can have a play around with it and see what suits you. But at the end of the day, that's a really great way to plot your stop loss on a chart. Now, obviously, if I've missed something, please let me know in the comments below, or if you have any other questions, feel free to leave a comment at my site, asxmarketwatch.com as well. I'm definitely around there a fair bit these days. And there's a lot of free videos and free courses at my site, asxmarketwatch.com as well. Keep in mind, I'm not a coder, I'm just a normal person figuring this stuff out. And you know, I really love sharing this stuff with you guys as well. I hope this has helped you in some small way. Happy trending until we meet again. Have a great week, guys, and bye for now.